Okay, because we have Margaret back, and I think yeah, we should start with Margaret. I'm sorry, Yahweh. Thank you very much for your talk.
Thank you very much.
Very nice talk. So you can answer. You can keep exchanging with Sanyang Su in the, okay, in the chat. Okay, I think it's the best. Okay. So then thank he you. Can help clarifying this. And there is also a question from Thomas Boyce there. I mean, Yahweh, you can reply directly in the question session. Okay. Okay, Margaret, welcome back. thank you for being here. And well, so these things happen. I mean, don't worry. There are a lot of supporting messages from the audience in the chat. I mean, they wait forever for you to listen your lecture. So no problem. So Fernando, maybe you can start sharing.
Absolutely.
So Fernando is going to share your slides, and well, you will simply say next, you know.
Okay. Good. Thank you very much for your patience. It's a big pleasure for me being here. I'm working on the experimental side of electrode manufacturing. The modeling side and simulation will be covered by Arno Flatz in tomorrow's presentation. We have a very close collaboration to him, and I will talk about manufacturing of electrodes with high areal capacity. Next slide, please. So, and the outline of my talk is that I first explain the challenges of manufacturing electrodes with high areal capacity, then the impact of electrode processing on the CBD gradient in the resulting product. And then I give some overview about manufacturing of structured electrodes we did in-house, successive coating of two layers or simultaneous two-layer coating, and at the end also a small introduction to mechanical structuring of electrodes. Next slide, please. So why we need electrodes with high aerial capacity? This would lead to an increase of energy density in the complete cell, the saving of materials cost, for example, separators and current collectors, and also saving of process cost. State of the art of cathode electrodes are about 4 milliampere hour per square centimeter. Our reference system has a little bit lower aerial capacity, and we are aiming for electrodes which have 8 milliampere hour per square centimeter. Next slide. But also the manufacturing of electrodes with high aerial capacity, or really thick electrodes, has some challenges. On the left side, you see the adhesion strength for the aerial capacity, and with increasing loading, the adhesion normally decreases. And from the photograph, you can also see that the electrode has some cracks. So that also the elasticity of the electrode is a severe problem if you are going to a roll-to-roll process. Next, and from the electrochemical testing, normally this high loaded electrode show limited kinetics and a quite high loss of rate capacity at higher rates. Therefore, next. Therefore, the attempt is to have a coupled approach of predictive simulation and experimental process research modeling and simulation to determine an optimized structure, microstructure for the electrode, and then trying to adjust the electrode manufacturing process for the thick electrodes. Next. So, and we heard from the former presentations that the electrode preparation starts with the dispersion process, with the slurry preparation. Here we see an example for an NCM622 electrode with 93% of active material, 4% of PVDF, 2% of carbon black, and 1% of graphite. And all the results you will see are normally with a loading of 50 milligrams per square centimeter. And here we see the normal process. You start with a dry mixing of carbon black, active material, graphite, and then you give this dry mixed powder to an NMP solution, and then you have the stepwise thinning until you get the complete end slurry. Next. And the result is not so very nice electrode, which shows some cracks in a roll to roll process with a very rigid behavior. Next. And if we change the process and start with a binder solution and a stepwise addition of the mixture of carbon black and active material, the result is a much more homogeneous electrode, which has a rigid behavior, which is quite elastic, and gives a very good homogeneous electrode without cracks. What's the reason therefore? Next. The rheology of both processes is completely different. On the one hand, we start with a very high viscosity and high shear stress for the whole process, and in the second part, we start with a very low viscosity. And during the whole process, we have a very low shear stress, which seems to be beneficial for the elasticity of the electrode. Next one. So, and if we have a look, what is the difference in the two electrodes prepared by this two different mixing processes, with the help of the University of Ulm, the group of Professor Volkmar Schmidt, who made a reconstruction of the electrodes, starting with image analysis to identify the amount of binder along the thickness of the electrode, and you can see here two different profiles. What you see on the axis is the distance to the separator, and you can see here that there is a gradient of the binder distribution, with a higher amount of binder near the separator and a lower amount of binder near the current collector. And here we have two different distributions, a stronger binder gradient for the mixing process with higher shear mixing, and a less pronounced binder gradient by the process with the low shear mixing, which results also in the properties of the electrode. Next one. This can also be seen in the electrochemical discharge curve, starting from this electrode tomograms or this simulated microstructure. The group of Arno Flatz did some modeling or simulation about the lithium distribution and the state of charge inside the electrodes, and you can see here on the right side the electrochemical discharge curve for this 8 milliampere hour per square centimeter electrodes at two different current densities, 1 milliamp per square centimeter and 8 milliamp per square centimeter, which refers to 1C. And you can see that there is a strong strong influence of the carbon binder distribution on the electrochemical performance. Please next. The dotted lines are the lines. The experimental results, and the other lines are the simulated results. And assuming an inverse binder distribution would result in the blue curve, a curve which gives much higher capacity at 8 milliamps per square centimeter. Next slide. So, and here you see the comparison of the electrodes with different loadings for a thinner electrode with 3.2 milliampere hour per square centimeter and the thick electrodes. And you see that there is a lot of room for improvement, and it's an increase of 1C capacity by a factor of 3 is predicted if we use this optimized carbon binder distribution in the electrode. How to reach this? Next slide. How is it possible to have this gradient arrangement of inside the electrodes? We started with different structuring concepts. The first one was to use successive two-layer coating with active materials with different particle sites. Next slide. So it's known from literature that the particle size distribution plays a role, and that smaller particles can show faster kinetics than larger one. Next. But there is also some hints in the literature that there is a critical thickness of the electrode without cracks, which is also dependent on the particle size, and here the critical thickness decreases with the particle radius. So this means that smaller particles have a lower critical thickness compared to larger particles. Next slide. So, and therefore we use this approach to have two moderately thick layers of materials to get improved overall kinetic by locally adjusted kinetics. Next slide. So there are also other literature showing that there is an could be an optimized variation of electrode porosity and active material particle sizes, but here there is an increase of capacity predicted at higher currents. However, on cost of the overall capacity for going to larger pore sizes also decreases the density of the electrode. Next. And there is a quite sophisticated work with a different simulation from the Ulrike Krever group, which predicted an optimization for low and high C rates and charge and discharge for adjusted layers of different particle sizes. Next. So, and what we did, we made a successive two-layer layer coating. Also, we have first the coating and the drying process. Then it's possible to have an intermediate calendaring and then a second coating with a final calendaring. Normally, we did not use the intermediate calendaring step. We directly made this two-layer coating. Next slide. And here, here you see what we aimed for was an 8 milliampere hour per square centimeter electrode with a density of 3.0. We used two different materials of NMC 622, one with a particle size D50 of 13 micrometer and the other one of 5.6 micrometer. On the left side, you see the rate capability at different current densities for homogeneous mixture of this particles and of single particles. And as you can see, there is absolutely no difference if we use smaller particles or larger particles, and also not for the homogeneous mixture. There's only a very small effect of particle size in the single layer NCM. Next. So, but if we go to the two-layer coating, we had two different approaches. One was on the bottom layer, the small particles, and on the top layer, the larger particles, and opposite. You can see that the spatial arrangement of particles with different sizes has a very high impact on the power density. And especially the second approach with the top layer with small particles shows much higher rate capability compared to the single layer coating. And we also have a gain of energy density at high currents without any loss of capacity at lower currents. Next slide. The other approach is to use a simultaneous two-layer slot die coating. Next slide. to have a customized passive material distribution inside the electrode. We saw before that the distribution of passive material has a strong impact on the kinetics. This is also known from simulation and from the literature. And the common phenomenon for all electrodes, especially for thick electrodes, that the binder migration to the top, there is a binder migration to the top of the electrode during the drying process, which leads to reduced adhesion and to reduced electrochemical performance. And there was this optimal binder distribution predicted by the simulation experiments, that it would be beneficial if we have a high binder binder content close to the collector and a low binder content close to the separator. Next, which is absolutely the opposite, which is normally observed during electrode manufacturing. And therefore, there is this approach to use a two-layer coating, a simultaneous coating, with different binder contents. Next one. So what we worked on in this normal process I have shown before, we start with 3.5% of binder in the slurry, and then after coating and drying, we end up with a gradient of binder with a high amount of binder near the separator. And in this two-layer arrangement, we use two different slurries, one slurry with a higher amount of binder, for example, 4% of binder, and a lower and a slurry with a lower amount of binder. Here you see the examples of two different mixtures. One mixture was to use 5.5% of binder for the lower layer, and only 1.5% of binder for the upper layer. This is the minimum of binder which can used for this individual binder system. If you go to lower amounts of binder, it's not possible to get the right rheology of the slurry for the slot die coating. Next. So also this two-layer configuration has been described in literature before, for example, from Liu, who used this approach, but for electrodes with more or less a moderate thickness. And what he showed, that a higher drying rate is possible if they work with this two-layer configuration. And there are recent results about water-based electrodes also using this dual layer coating to increase the rate capability on an anode. Next slide. So to come back, we made here 50 milligram per square centimeter electrodes, and tried to have exactly the same amount of active mass loading in both both layers, so that we have that we only have the effect of the carbon binder migration, and the density and so should be more or less the same. It's not completely completely the same, but we try to adapt the amount of active material. Next slide. So of course, this mixing and coating process is very complex. If you change one component or the concentration on one component in the slurry, you change more or less the complete system. For the formulation has a strong influence of the dispersion process, and of course also on the rheological properties of the suspension. And these properties determine the behavior during coating and after coating. What we have normally in the process that we need different shear rates. For example, the slot die coating is at shear rates about 250 per second. Then you have the rest time or the leveling time after the coating is finished, which has more or less zero. Then these slurries have a different solid content, and the solid content determines the wet film thickness and also the drying rate, and also during drying the viscosity changes very much. And here you can see that, for example, the red curve for different binder content, this is viscosity at the shear rate for the slot die. This should be not so different, but you can see that the other parameters are strongly influenced by this, so that you get change in viscosity at the leveling time, and also you get a big change in the solid content. This means there is a very complex correlation between the different parameters. Only one parameter can be adjusted, the others will result, for these parameters are not independent. And sort of this development is absolutely necessary to understand a little bit more the electrode production process, and it's still ongoing. Next slide. So then we also have the influence of the wet film thickness of the individual layers. Next. And here you can see the influence of the thickness for the upper layer and the bottom layer. And what's also different is the drying behavior. So we always observe a small shrinking of the upper layer. This has also to be taken into account, and it's still under investigation to solve all this or to understand the correlations and to solve all these problems. Next slide. But the result you see here, the gray one is the single layer coating. The red one is the double coating with 4% and 3% of binder, and the both blue ones are with the stronger binder binder deviations at different dryings. And what we can see here, in principle, the adhesion decreased, but it's sufficient for further processing. We see from the image analysis that we have more binder near the collector for the multi-layer case. Question is, did we reach this inverse configuration? And the rate capability increased drastically. If you see on the right side, the volumetric discharge capacity against the current current density, there is a big improvement for the multi-layer electrodes. And here from the synchrotron tomography and the reconstruction of the electrodes, we can see that the black curve is the normal curve we had at the beginning, and the red curve is for the multi-layer coating with only a very small amount of binder in the upper layer, that we have an inverse binder gradient achieved. And what we also achieved is a much better electrochemical capacity, which fits exactly to the prediction from modeling, and also taking the parameters from the experimental electrodes to a simulation, you see that there is a very good agreement between electrochemical results. These are the dotted curves and simulation curves. On the right side, you can see these are always three cells from the experimental measurements, and the cells are in very good agreement, and can also see that there is a strong increase of capacity for the electrodes. Okay. So in this case, the predicted microstructure from simulation was successfully achieved in experiment. Normally we had the opposite, that the simulation comes to the same result than the experimental curve. Here we had a predicted microstructure from simulation, which could be achieved by adapting the electrode process, an excellent agreement between electrochemical measurements and simulation. And maybe you can go a few slides. So next slide. Next slide. Not. No. Don't go. Please go to. Please go to the summary. I think that my time is.
No, you still have time, Margaret.
Okay. I didn't follow the time. I have the feeling that I need more time if I say next.
You have 10 more minutes. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. This is fine.
Don't worry. I give you a 5-minute warning. So keep going.
Okay. Good. What we saw here, we have this double mixing capacity is showed very good results. What is necessary for this? In principle, you need an additional mixer or an additional storage tank. Also for you have we are working with two different slurries.
Fernando, the slurry disappear.
Yeah.
Also you can you also need a slot die equipment which can be used for a double slot die coating, but the process time is quite quite low. For in this case, we do not have a successive coating. We do all the steps in one approach. But of course, you need a little bit different equipment, and what also has to be adjusted is the drying rate, which has also a quite big influence on the product. But this is something I have not shown today. It's also still under investigations. If you can go one slide back, please.
One slide back, sorry. There you were.
Okay, the viscosity has to be adjusted, but in principle, this is a quite promising method. Thick electrodes can be produced with a common or even faster drying process. The electrodes have very good mechanical properties, very good roll-to-roll behavior, winding behavior, and the loss of power in thick electrodes can be drastically reduced. So, and then we come to the last attempts. Next slide. In literature, also other methods are described to increase the kinetics of electrodes with high loadings. Something which is under investigation, for example, is the laser perforation or mechanical perforation, to build channels inside the electrode to have a better electrolyte update and to increase the lithium diffusion, also to have a beneficial effect on the tortuosity of the electrode. Next slide, please. So, and this is not from our work, this is from literature, but I think these are also promising attempts to structure electrodes, for example, by selective ablation with a pulse laser. Then you get improved, increased surface area and improved lithium ion diffusion. Also, reduction of over potentials is reported, and especially on the anode side, improved fast charging by avoiding of lithium plating during charging. But these methods also have some drawbacks. This is the heat accumulation during laser application, which can lead to thermal damage of the material. There is a loss of active material, and especially on the cathode side, the active material is a quite expensive component. There are losses of 5 to 30% reported in literature. Traces of powder have to be removed. This is also especially true for the cathode material, which contain toxic dust, like cobalt or nickel containing dust. And you have an additional process which leads to processing processing time, but all in all a quite interesting method to get a better better understanding on the electrodes. And then we come to the last slide, to the summary. The carbon binder gradient in thick electrodes has a strong impact on the electrochemical performance. It's influenced by both by the mixing process, by the slurry preparation process, and of course also by the drying process of the electrode. There are different structuring concepts appropriate to customize or to optimize the microstructure of the electrodes. I think this work is just at the beginning. It's not at the end. It's just at the beginning. For example, particle blend layers of active materials by successive two-layer coatings, or optimization of passive material gradient by simultaneous two-layer coatings. And one promising direction for the future would be to make both. For example, at the moment for this two-layer coatings, we do not know the binder gradient. Also combining particle size blends with binder gradients would be a quite interesting direction for the future. And the methods differ with respect, of course, to the process, also to the necessary equipment, processing time, and complexity of the respective process. This would be an issue for example, for cost predictions. But both methods lead to significant increase of power density for ultra-thick electrodes. And then I like to thank my co-workers. Next slide. From ZSW, Alice Hoffmann, who is responsible for the processing. Here in ZSW, Emanuel Heider, Lea Krämer, Nos Albrecht, Jan Thomas, Christian Dreher und Thomas Meinecke hier in ZSW. Then from the Institute of Mathematics at the University of Ulm, Daniel Westhoff, Benedikt Briefling and Volker Schmidt for the nice reconstruction and image analysis, and the group of Arno Flatz, Timo Danner and Simon Hein for the modeling work. And of course, I also like to thank the funding agency. The work was funded by the Federal Ministry of Education and Research in the framework of the so-called ProCell cluster. The ProCell cluster here in Germany is a cluster dedicated to electrode and cell manufacturing processes. And within there are two projects, the project High Energy and the new project, which is called High Structure. And I also like to thank all the members of this ProCell cluster for fruitful discussion and many hints, discussions, and sometimes also frustrations in electrode or cell manufacturing. This is really very nice collaboration there. And at the end, I also want to thank you for your attention. And I'm very sorry for all the problems I caused with my presentation and so on. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Margaret, for the wonderful, wonderful presentation. So very inspirational for people like us, know that we are intending to do models of the processing, and your presentation clearly shows that it's a very complex process, and most likely from a computational point of view, so we need to combine different tools, right, to simulate each step along the process and to account for the different scales which are involved. So thank you very much. So, Fernando, I think we have a lot of questions waiting for Margaret. People love your talk, Margaret. So.
Exactly, we have many questions, so we are going to go with those that are more upvoted because probably we are not going to be able of covering them all. So here we start with a question by Ankur Sharma, who asks, what will be the effect of multi-layer coding on the cyclic stability of NMC622? And also, what will be your thought on transformation-induced plasticity-driven stress instability or multi-layer electrodes during electrochemical delithiation?
So, also the first question was, the first question was, what will be the effect of cycling stability? I did not show results of cycling stability, but the cyclic stability is quite good, and of course it depends with what do you compare, but the cycling stability of the dual coating process is comparable to the cycling stability of the single coated steps, and it seems not to be a difference between cycling stability of multi-layer coatings compared to single-layer coatings. If you compare the same loadings of the electrode, of course, if you compare thin electrodes with thick electrodes, is a difference. But there is no drawback for cycling stability.
Great. Thank you, Margaret. So, Fernando, I think we can pick a question from Chao Yue. So, it's three votes. So, we will do democratically.
Absolutely. The ones that have more votes will be taken first. So, here we have another question by Chao Lui from NRCS, actually. So, he asks you, Margaret, what do you think about the effect of binder mechanical property on electrode performance? Take, for instance, graphite silicon electrode as an example for its huge volume change. Do you think it's better to have a softer binder or a stiffer one?
This is a quite good question. In my talk, I focused on the cathode side, but of course, we are also working on the anode side. For graphite silicon, I do not really know the answer. It seems also depend on the silicon. For example, we have for some silicon electrodes very good results with polyacrylic acid binders, which lead to a more rigid behavior in the electrodes. It's from processing, it's not so easy in a large process, but here we have quite good result. For other silicon samples, it does absolutely not work, and therefore I think especially for carbon silicon, it's very hard to answer.
Okay, thank you. So here we also have the question by Mikolaj Nowak, who asks, as far as I remember, PVDF can be characterized by various polymer chain lengths. Do you think we could see a difference in performance if we apply PVDF with either short or long polymer length? Would longer polymer chains, less mobile, impede binder migration during the drying process?
This is a very good question. We always use the same PVDF, and frankly spoken, I cannot tell you what is the polymer chain length of this. For we have, also in the past, we made some screening experiments, not for the thick electrodes, but for the cathodes in general. And then we selected one PVDF binder, and we have not changed this anymore. But I think, of course, this will also have an influence on the binder migration. Yes.
Great. Perfect. I think we can pick the one of Teo Lombardo.
Three votes. That was the one coming next. So here, Teo asks you, Margaret, do you think this extra cost of equipment, etc., of producing multi-layers electrodes or complex electrode architectures like micropillars can be counterbalanced by the benefits of producing better performing electrodes? In other terms, do you think industries will invest on it?
So this is dependent on the gain in performance. In my opinion, the cost for the industry is of course investment cost at the beginning, but then also process time and product quality. Therefore, I think that processes which do not have an additional step, prolong the process time, and also if you have different processes step after step, you also need different quality insurance for individual steps. Therefore, I think, for example, for this double slot die coating, it's only that you need another slot die equipment, but there is no extra process, or the quality insurance can be made at the same. If I think that industry would invest in something, but investment is always a question: what is the assured product quality, and how is the relation about running cost and investment cost at the beginning?
Thank you.
Great.
Well, maybe we can take a final question that has been getting many votes. So this is a final question before moving to the next talk. So here we have Jianhan Chong, who asks, adding more binder to the bottom layer against the binder migration to gain more adhesivity, as a result, more binder was found close to current collector, but the adhesive strength decreased. Is this binder interacts well with CC?
With current collector?
Yeah, the current collector first.
Yeah, this is the adhesion is also we made for the whole electrode. I think that the adhesion to the current collector is sufficient also for the thick electrodes.
Wonderful. Okay. Thank you, Margaret, for your answers.
Thank you very much, Margaret, once again, for a wonderful presentation. I mean, for a great discussion. And, well, we are very much looking forward to see the results of your ongoing research.
And, thank you very much, and thank you for your patience.
No. Thank you very much for joining us today. It was really great. Thank you. It's a great honor for us. Thank you, Margaret.
Thank you.